Glory to God. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord, everybody. So grateful this day for God's goodness and everything that God is doing for us in this season. What, isn't it awesome to think that we are just in a few days, in a few weeks from now, going to be celebrating Palm Sunday as well as celebrating Resurrection Morning. And a lot of people are planning, and we are planning as well. We're planning, looking forward to being able to celebrate. You know, this celebration is going to be even more special than any year. And you say, well, why? Is it because you're coming back to the church or whatever, whatever? It's just that every year brings us closer to the coming of the Lord. Every year brings us closer. And we know we're not exactly sure upon what day or the exact time of everything when it came to the birth and the death of Christ, but we are somewhere in the ballpark. And being in the ballpark just reminds me of how great it is to be able to know that Jesus died on the cross for us. So I want to give a shout out to our churches and to those of you who follow us in ministry and those of you who are just logging on, just finding out about this great ministry. I want to tell you, we're the house. Matter of fact, the Lord gave this to me years ago, is the house of millions. You know, we want to minister to millions. Now, why don't you help me to do that? Let's minister to millions of people. If you can, if you will, why don't you consider being a partner with this ministry? We want to reach millions of people. We want to reach to the level of the giftedness and the mind, the plan of the Lord. So the house of millions, that's what I want you to think about, because that's what we want to reach. We want to reach millions of people. So partner with us. Look and see how you can do this. You can get on Giblify. You can do it by Cash Apping. You can do it by sending a contribution to JBC and even being a part of For Gospel. But we want to reach millions of people, millions of people. And we believe that we hadn't scratched the surface. So help me to do that. Somewhere, somebody needs to hear what God has to say to the earth. And the word that God has placed in my spirit to share, I want to share it. So would you come a partner? Would you partner with us here? Partner with J.G. Rogers Ministries as well as JBC and For Gospel. You know what I'm looking forward to? One day saying we have $1 million donor. I'm looking for $1 million donors. That's right. I believe that God can give us that. $1 million donors. You know, with the fact that people all over the world come into money, and sometimes when you come into money, you want to partner with the church, or you have a relative, or you have a friend that says, what church, what pastor what you want to be a blessing with? Tell them about us. Talk about us, because we want to reach millions. We want to reach millions, the house of millions. And that's my goal. That's a vision that I feel that God has certainly placed in my heart to reach millions. Help me to do just that. Help us to become the house of millions. All right, so let's look into the word today. And I just want to remind everybody again, get online, stay online, look at some of the Bible classes that I've been teaching. You know, it is a primary theme of roaring back now moving forward, you know, we got to come back. We got to really come back. So that's what our job and our assignment is to come back as a church. All right. So let's help me to do that, if you will. Let's all. I don't care. You say, well, I'm not in this city and I'm not a part of, but I go to this church, that church, whatever. You know, you need to come roaring back. We want the houses of God, the churches of the living God, to come back strong. With everything coming back, everything trying to come to a place of normalcy, may the church come roaring back. May the church come roaring back. All right, look with me in the Word. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your kindness and your grace. Thank you, Lord, for everything you've done and everything you're doing in this season. Lord, speak, God, through us. Speak, God, for your glory. Speak, Lord, let your will be done. Say those things that only can be said through you. We ask for your help, God, in all things today. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, praise the Lord again to everybody, to Full Gospel, to JBC, to the wonderful saints in the Philippines, to our friends and family, to our audience. Thank you for tuning in again. Look, if you will, with me, and the book of Galatians chapter 6, verse 9, is where I want to get my primary scripture that I want to use as my subject. And it says, and let us not be weary in well doing, for in due season we shall reap if we faint not. And let us not be weary in well doing, for in due season we shall reap if we faint not. So I was looking at this text, this scripture, and I was reading it in the Amplified Version. And the Amplified Version reads like this, and let us not lose heart and grow weary and faint in acting nobly and doing right, for in due time and at the appointed season we shall reap if we don't loosen and relax our courage and faint. Don't lose heart, it says. Grow weary and faint in acting nobly and doing right. For in due time, at the appointed season, we shall reap if we do not loosen and relax our courage. Let us not lose heart. Isn't that a good thought to start with today? As we start rounding, looking toward the end of things, finishing well. As we begin to just think about what do we want to be said about us? What do we want? The last things about our life. The last things about our lives, we want it to be how well we lasted to the end. The most important part is not always how you start, but it is how you finish. So the Apostle Paul deals with the finish. But he gives somewhat a warning. And that warning is, you can lose heart. You can get close to the end, and you can start fading, getting tired. You can start losing the main thing and lose that. The main thing here is not just what? It's not just being in the race. It's how I'm finishing the race. So now I understand even more about how important endurance is. What our endurance is like. So Paul gives a great idea of how the endurance should be toward the end. And it is so important that we understand that, because we're looking every day at an end. Every day, critically, we're looking at ends. We're looking at ends. We're looking at the end of people's lives, the end of their story, the end of what their life is going to be about. We're looking at the end of COVID, or the end of this period of not being vaccinated from COVID, the end of the fear, and maybe not, I don't mean the end of it, but we were looking at the potential protection from what COVID is about in this season. So as we begin to look at ends, and as we look at trying to finish, then we have to be reminded that when you were doing good, you cannot allow the end to not be your best. So the Apostle Paul talks about sowing. And he talks about doing good things. And he's talking about continuing to do good things to people in church, in the body of Christ. He called it the household of faith. And then he talks about in opportunities with all men, which mean even people in the community. But he makes these statements because what he's trying to get people to understand is the value of focusing on what is going to give you your greatest value down the road. So he makes it clear, it is in how you sow. It is in how you give. He's not talking about just the natural part of giving resources. He's talking about the giving of your life in doing good things and helping people. And even with that, you would see that he's always also making it clear that there is a certain level of sowing or giving of your resources that is important as well. But here, he gives us the importance of what it means to be good or doing good things. So why is this so important? It's because you can get tired of doing good things. You can get to the point where you think in your mind that because I'm doing good things, I'm being used. And you say, I'm doing good things, and you say, I'm being manipulated. And why should I serve other people? Because giving to people, ain't nobody giving to me. And all of these things about giving and sowing, that somebody would think that this is being, nobody is giving to me. So Paul makes it clear that as we move toward this end, this is something that can happen to any of us and all of us. And notice he uses the word, and let us not be weary. Because Paul was making great sacrifices himself. And the Apostle Paul had given himself to God and to the Word of God. And he was receiving persecution. And he was receiving stripes. And he had marks and physical marks in his body. How he was beat and the persecution that he received. And how people hated him. And the Apostle Paul is saying, in spite of all the things that I have gone through, and in spite of all the bad things that's been happening in my life since I have come to Christ, he said, listen, that is nothing. Because Paul said, I'm crucified to this world. Because my greatest value is in what I'm doing for God. Brothers and sisters, I like to believe that that's where all of us need to be focusing on, is that as I'm dealing with ends, as I'm dealing with finishes, as I'm dealing with the coming of the Lord, I want to be more conscious to deliberately do good things. I want to act intentionally when it comes to doing good. I want to do it. I want to do it when I got a chance. I want to do it when the opportunity comes, when I can do something nice, when I can do something that is in the area of serving and in the area of giving. I don't want to be at this place that I feel like that I've given all I'm going to give and I'm not going to give anymore. You know, the Bible talks about that in the last days. He said the perilous times shall come. And he says, for men shall be lovers of themselves. And I think the Apostle Paul is making us aware that it's a possibility that if you don't watch it, as you get to the end, you can fall prey to an evil influence of this time. And that's taking care of just me. When it's all about you, it's all about your passion, your desires, and you allow the spirit of this time to overtake you. Look at what he says again, for men shall be lovers of themselves. When men begin to love themselves and care only about themselves, he lays out a lot of other things that will be characteristics that you will find within that person. And then he begins to say, as he lined them out, he said, for they shall be boasters. He said, they shall be boasters. They shall be covetous. You know what covetous means? Is when people want something that somebody else has. Boasters, bragging and boasting about themselves, being not only boasters, but being people who try to intimidate other folks. Proud, look at it. Blasphemers, talking ill about the house of God, ill about the Holy Ghost, ill about the saints, ill about righteous things, ill about things that are good, putting it down, tearing it down. And he says, this is what happens when people begin to love themselves. He says, because this is what I want you to stay away from. I don't want you to ever get into this mindset. And he says, disobedient to parents. Children don't want to listen to their parents anymore. Unthankful, unholy, not grateful for things. Always never getting enough. Always wanting to come to them. Never seeing that it's not just about you. It's about being able to give to others. Unholy. Yes, right. Don't want to live the life that God requires. Don't want to obey the word of God. Want to live according to that flesh. Unholy. He said, look at it again. He said, without natural affections. Losing their origin of how they were created, origin of their of what was natural, the origin of what is natural to love, the origin of what is natural to want to have. My God. Well, having affections, which is affections, in other words, desires for things, that's wrong. My God, you cannot love the same sex and think that is proper. But he says, in selfishness, in a time, in the last days, he said, you will see that truce breakers can't stay with the covenant. Can't stay in that covenant with people. Can't stay in their marriages. Can't keep a promise. You can't, that word don't mean anything. Whatever they say, it has no value. And he says, truce breakers, false accusers, willing to speak ill about people you don't even know. Were you there? Do you actually know? No, I just heard something. I just heard what somebody else said. False accusers. Look at it. Incontinent, without control. Fierce. That's right. That's right. Fierce. Isn't that a strong word? Fierce. I mean, that's like having a kind of intimidating way with people. Despisers of those that are good, and people that are good, you just don't like them. I don't like this person. I don't know. Well, what have they done to you? No, just these preachers and these saints, saints that act like they ain't never done wrong. I don't like them. Brothers and sisters, despisers of those that are good. Then he said, traitors, betraying. You can't trust them. They betray you. One way in your face, another way behind your back. Heady, high-minded. Lovers of pleasures more than lovers of God. Traitors. He said, this is the spirit that is going to happen in the last days. Look at this. Lovers of pleasures more than lovers of God. Rather have their time in worldly things than have their time in things with God. Don't want to be in church. Don't want to come to church. Don't want to hear people talk about church. Don't want to hear about Bible class. Don't want to come to Bible class. Don't want to hear about people praying and fasting. Lovers of pleasures, I ain't got time. I ain't got time for prayer. I ain't got time for spending my time in these things with the church. I don't like church people. I don't like to be around church people. Listen to that stuff. Lovers of pleasures more than lovers of God. I ain't got time for that. I got my own desires, own things. You going to church? No, man, I got things I got to do. Lovers of pleasures more than lovers of God. Don't stop. Recognize that you owe God. You owe God your time. You owe God your mind. You owe God your life. You better stop where you are and recognize that you got to give yourself fully back to God. Having a form of godliness. Mm-hmm. Look like you in the church. Look like you about God. But look, denying the power thereof. It not allowing the power of God to operate and to bring about the change that he needs to bring about. My God, God can kill anything. God can destroy anything. The power of God can break any yoke, can destroy any yoke. Form of godliness, denying the power thereof, not letting it work in your life. Not giving the anointing, the Spirit, the Holy Ghost, the preeminence be in control of your life. He said, check it out. Is it from of this sort? Are they which creep into houses and lead captive silly women laden with sins, led away with divers lust? My God. He says, think about this. He says, when you find these self-centered things, this selfishness, he said, you're going to find what lust is going to be on the rampage. You're going to find what lust is going to be pulling people out of relationships, pulling them out of their commitments, out of their marriage. And you're going to see how it's going to just run them away from God. Look at that. And look what he says when he says, laden with sins, led away with divers lust. Divers mean different kinds of lust, different kinds of behaviors, of passions wanting to feel. Look at it, ever learning and ever and never able to come to the knowledge of the truth. And then he talks about an example of people who got caught up into that, Jannes and Jambres, and he talks about how they were corrupt minds, resisted Moses, resisted the truth, and reprobate. It's when God see you a certain way and he see you don't want to be changed, that you don't want to quit that stuff, and he just let you go. My brothers and sisters, he said, but they shall proceed no further, for their folly shall be manifest unto all men, as theirs also was. In other words, it's not going to be hidden. It's not going to be not revealed, because whatever is taking place is going to come out in your life. You can cover up some of it for a long time, but eventually it's going to come. Now, what he's trying to say, or what he's saying to us, is that that's why you got to understand that you can't stop doing what's good, because you have to understand that while we are stopping or feeling like I've done enough church things, I've done enough things about God, now I'm gonna do for myself. Understand that it is important that you continue to stay in God, continue to keep doing the things toward God. Never allow yourself to get weary in doing good things. What am I trying to remind myself of? Because when I lose my focus and get to the place where I say I've done enough for God, I've done enough trying to serve, I've done enough trying to do good deeds, now I'm gonna take care of me. Brothers and sisters, the Apostle Paul was talking to the people, getting them to see, getting them to remember. It's not just a challenge for you, it's a challenge also for me. Brothers and sisters, that's where I can take a break and say the same thing, because the same thing that's challenging you are the same things that's challenging me. Whatever has been is the same thing that's trying to be again. Whatever has been a part of my life and whatever's been a part of your life is trying to be a part of your life again. That's why it is so important that you understand why we got to get back in church, why we got to get back in fellowship of the Spirit of God, because what's out there is trying to get back inside. Never forgot one of the lessons of demonic possession. I remember one of the lessons I had when I was praying. I stopped by a property or a home of a saint of God, and they were in spiritual bondage. And before I got there, some other saints had stopped by, and they were praying for that household because the enemy was attacking that family. And as they were praying, they were glad when I showed up with some of the brothers with me. And as they left a part of that job and surrendered it to me, somehow I became a part of it. And as I began to pray, I could see in my spiritual eye demonic war, the demonic spirits leave this person. And as I could see that those spirits were gone, but I could also look out the window and could see them not fully off the premises, but somewhere outside waiting on us to stop praying, waiting on us to stop fighting this warfare, and hoping that we would stop because they were trying to get back in. Brothers and sisters, I want you to think about that, because I want everybody to know that when you came to Christ, you didn't come on your own. He led you. He bought you. You were brought in by him. It's not in a man to direct his own steps. The Bible said you can't come unless you are drawn. There was a drawing taking place. He said, you have not chosen me, but I've chosen you. You didn't choose God. God chose you. You got to remember that choosing God, you only obey when God came to you. And he came to you and he pulled you out of a rescue, rescued you from the evil. He rescued you from a lifestyle, rescued you from the work of darkness. He bought you out of that because he had a plan for your life. You got to recognize that. That's why it is so important to you to recognize that as I look at this earth, and as I look at everything around me, I'm looking at ends, and ends means finish. Ends means things are just about over. And some people, because of this disease that's out here, at any moment, you can get a part of that variance, and something could happen and you could not even recover from it. So that's why you have to focus on the fact that let the last words that come forth out of your mouth, the last things that come forth about your life, be what God, this is how I want to end. I want to end well. So Paul says it right, because Paul was looking at his own end. And he said, let us not be weary in well-doing. This ain't time. This ain't time for you to put up and say, I ain't gonna do no more. This ain't time for you to say, I'm quitting. I'm not gonna fight no more. This ain't the time for you to stop. My God, if you're weary, you need to get your wind, your second wind. And that's what the Apostle Paul is saying. It's just like finishing a race. There is another wind we need for this last day. Brothers and sisters, I'm trying to say it. The Spirit of the Lord wants you to know that it's so critical that at the end, he said, don't get tired. Don't get tired. Don't lose your focus on sowing and reaping. Don't lose your focus on what you can reap if you faint not. What is it, what is good that is going to be coming for you? The good that's going to be in your history. The good that is going to be if I close my eyes. I got something good that's for my future. Brothers and sisters, he said, don't be tired. Don't be tired. And I want to say it again, because it's easy to lose heart when you start looking at other people and how they're living. It's easy to lose heart when you hear other people say, I'm not going to do no more. I'm tired. I'm quit. I ain't going no further. It's easy to lose heart when you start listening to other people as they're giving their comments and saying why they're quitting and why they're not going to work at doing the job anymore. That's why you can't let them do this to you. So Paul said, let me put myself in here with you, because I've gone through enough to tell you I know what you're feeling. But let us not be weary. Let us not get tight. Let us not lose heart. Let us not allow what is taking place in this earth right now to make us feel like we ought to just throw in the towel. brothers and sisters, I want you to get up. I want you to go to church. I want you to get back in this fight. I want you to treat people good. I want you to speak good about people. I want you to try to keep doing good. Make yourself a blessing. Be a blessing. Anybody's presence, you come in, bless them. Speak good. Let them have a memory that the last words you spoke were words of encouragement. Remember, God says in his word, and I love it, in the book of Matthew, he tells us, and Luke, and he tells us that it's important that we understand the position of who we are in God. He said, either you with me or you against me. God has nobody that can sit home on one side of the fence one way, another side another way. You got to be all the way in here. So what am I trying to say to you? He says, you either on my side or you against me. He said, either you're gathering or you are scattering. That means, brothers and sisters, that means as I look at this end, I want to keep gathering. I want to keep being the reason why people are trying to love God. I want to keep being the reason why people love God more. I want to keep being the reason why people want to be saved. I want to keep being the reason why people want to get their life right. I want to keep being the reason why people have spiritual motivation. I want to keep being the reason why people can overcome discouragement. I want to keep being the reason why people can say, I'm not going to faint. Think about it again. He said, we will, what? He said, if we faint not, if, and I want to say about that if. He said, if we faint, and I want you to put something with that if, and said, if I don't allow the distractions of this time, if I don't allow the lust of this time, if I don't allow the mess in this day, if I stay out of the mess, if I stay out of, because some of us have tendencies to like confusion. Some of us like to gossip, and some of us like to speak ill about people. But let me tell you some brothers and sisters, it ain't nobody worth you messing up your life, destroying your reputation, destroying your good works, putting other people down. Whatever their story is, your word ought to, I like the fact that the Bible teaches us that our words ought to be seasoned with salt. It'll be ministering grace to the people that hear us. And that's why you got to say, if I faint not, if I faint not, if I faint not, he said, if I don't go backwards, brothers and sisters, you got to understand. He said, let us not be weary in due season if we faint not, if you don't allow whatever it is that has been a struggle in your life to pull you out, if you don't allow that thing that you're struggling with to make you give up under the power of it, if you don't allow what is easily a weight, easily a setback sin, talk about easily being beset by spiritual things, if you don't allow that person or those persons or that behavior, if you don't allow that failure, if you don't allow the thing that is so big in your eyes that can cause you to lose heart, he said, if you don't, if you look at that thing and say, I won't, if I don't get so depressed because somebody left me, if I don't get so depressed because I'm caught up in rejection, if I don't allow whatever it is, I don't know what your distraction is, I don't know what your weakness or your flaw is, I don't know what the if is in your life, but I hear Paul say, if you don't faint, if you don't let it overtake you, if you don't let somebody else's problems overtake you and make you pick up their ways, don't let other people's behavior, other people's sin. That's why the Bible talks about evil communication, corrupt good manners. If you don't let other people's negative communication get in your spirit and make you negative, he said, if you don't faint, if you don't get weary, if you faint not. So that's what I got to drop in your spirit, because that's what it's about losing heart. And here is a time when everything is happening around us, we can easily lose heart. We can easily allow the negativity. Our heads on a swivel, just moving from one side to side, this and that, and that and this and this and that. Somebody saying this over here, and somebody saying that over there, and somebody said this, and somebody said that, and this is happening, and that is happening, that. I said, brothers and sisters, understand what can happen and what you can lose. Said, so here is what he says. And you pick it up in verse number 10. And he talks about the opportunity that's given. We have an opportunity. And that opportunity is to keep doing what's good. And that's what I want to tell you, keep doing what's good. As we have that for opportunity, let us do good. And to all men, verse 10, let's do good. That's the opportunity, let's keep doing good. And all men, especially unto those in the household of faith. Look at verse number 6, that him that is taught in the word communicate unto him that teaches in all good things. You see, sometimes people get offended in the church and they don't want to do good. They don't want to support the church. They don't want to support the minister. They don't want to support the house of God, the ministers. They don't want to do that anymore. And this is what you shouldn't let happen to you. Let me tell you this. Have you ever seen somebody called by God? They got a history of things, of good works, things that God has used them in. And I can always say for myself, let my work speak for me. Let the record of the people who God has used me to speak a word in their life and then come to know Christ. Backsliders who come back to God, people who've gotten filled with the Holy Ghost, and my record speaks for itself. You can never look at somebody, you can never look at me and say anything other than the fact that whatever he is, God blessed him. God blessed the work of his hand. Let him that is taught in the word communicate. So Don't try to hold your good things back. Hold your good things because you get the word here. Those of you hear the word, those of you been part of this ministry, you get the word here. Don't hold your good things back. Don't hold the good things back. Your resources, don't hold them back. Don't hold back your talent. Don't hold back your service. You've been getting, you ought to continue to serve because why? Because you're communicating back to me. Which means you're giving, you're giving back. Giving back, Lord. If you ain't got the money to give, but you can give your time to help the work that's being done here in this church and the church has. Communicate back. Now, this is giving, this is resources. But this is also good things. I could have made this a lesson on good things, because it's all about good, because he's finishing talking about good. And he want to tell you that good's coming back to you, because good is something that you're sowing. And when you see it as something that I sow, then you recognize that God is going to grow what you sow. And you're going to reap what you sow. And you got to focus on, that's why I want to do good. That's why I got to be good. That's why good is going to be the history of what I do. Because I got to be good. Because my finish, as I'm finishing doing good. I won't finish doing bad. I'm going to finish doing good. I felt that. I'm going to finish doing good. Let us not be weary in doing good. Good opportunity. Opportunity to do good unto all men. Especially in the household of faith. Especially. Great emphasis. witnesses. Listen, don't speak ill of each other. Don't speak ill of someone in the house of faith. I might disagree with you, but I ain't speaking ill of you because I love you. Because what? That ain't doing good. That's not doing good. It's not doing good. The record of a person, if they're in Christ, the record speaks for themselves. The record speaks for themselves. A tree is known by the fruit that it bears. That's why I can say, you can check my fruit. You can check my tree. You can check what God has allowed my tree to produce. You don't declare a tree just by what they say. You look for its fruit. I thank God for the good. Thank God for the good that He's done through me, that He's allowed me to be a part of. But as I close, as we come to the end of things, or the potential end, good gotta be the end. Good gotta be the finish. Good gotta be the story. Can it be about good things? About good conversation, I'm about good living, I'm about good relationships. It's good, that's what I'm about. If it's good is in it, and if it's giving glory to God, I'm in that. Sign me up. But if you're looking for somebody to blaspheme, to tear down, to beat people up, and whatever, that ain't me. If you're looking for the encouragement, you're looking for somebody to console, you're looking for somebody, I tell people, because I believe it's important, you want somebody to encourage your marriage, you can call me. You want somebody to tear it up, that's not my job. If you want to live, if you want somebody that'll hold on with you, I'll hold on with you for life. Look, somebody gave you and said, kill it. I'm not the killer. I'm the bridge to help you. I've enjoyed this today. I hope it's been a blessing to your life. I've already talked to you about what you can do. But what about your spirit now? You can repent and ask God to forgive you. And God will forgive you right now. And you can get your life back right. Why don't you take that time right now? Call us here at the church. 662-207-5651. Call us, let us know. If nobody's answered, leave the message, we'll get back with you. 912-351-0423, call us here. We want to help you, we want to help God, let God do a work in your life. Reach us on Facebook, go online, look at, you can go to my fan page, if you can get it, you can go to JBC, reach out, leave a message. You can go to www.jbc-paw. Go to our website. Reach us. Reach out. Even if you're reaching out for Mississippi, reach out and we'll get the message back to them. Wherever you are from, whatever area you're in, this is time. We love you. God bless you. And Father, would you save those who come to you? You said you won't turn them away. So, Father, we lift a prayer for those who are trying to get it back together. Those who right now have tears in their eyes because they're convicted, God. They're convicted by what they think, do, and say. And they're trying to get back on track. And, Father, I pray now that word would just germinate, just bring forth all the fruit that the sprouts. Let it sprout, let the seed begin to germinate, let it sprout, and let it bring forth the fruits of a change in their life. God, do a work right now. Do a work right now in the hearts of those who want to be right, who are thinking about not losing heart in this last day. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
God bless you. fill me up till I